Well, are you in for a treat this afternoon? But my first question is, how was the town hall? Well, if you think that was something, wait till you hear what our presenter has to say to you today, because you could search the entire globe. You could not find a more appropriate speaker for this networking luncheon than we have found. And she is someone who I've known for many, many, many years, who has been praying for me and helping me as I've moved along. But my job is not to introduce the speaker, but I do want to send my love. My job as the chair of the foundation is to greet you and to introduce and have you acknowledge the two co-chairs for this, our 43rd annual legislative conference. And let me put this in perspective. I was just down here saying hello at some of the tables to some of our registrants, and I met a young woman who has been to 43 out of 43. She's been here each and every year. Now hold it, you gotta give an applause for that. Now, Dr. Allison she's got a pink hat on, she's down here in the second row, but as chairman, you know, one of the things we know about in Washington, when you get to be chair, you get all the power. So, you know, we're going to do something very nice for her to acknowledge her stick-to-itiveness, her persistence, her willingness to overcome whatever the sacrifices were so that she could have this continuous connection with the Congressional Black Caucus Annual Legislative Conference. So let's just give her a big round of applause. And let me introduce our two co-chairs. Now, these are two of the most dynamic people ever elected to the U.S. Congress. Donna Edwards, who represents the great state of Maryland, and Cedric Richmond, who represents Louisiana. And these two were selected to be the co-chairs and have been heavily involved. Every week we've met for many, many months, planning these multiple days that you're going to be here in Washington. And so everything that you like about these next 4 days, these are the two people responsible. And anything that goes wrong, you can blame it on me. Congresswoman Donna Edwards and Congressman Cedric Richmond. Give them a round of applause.
Thank you very much, Chairman Fatan. It's so wonderful to be here with you. I get great pleasure this afternoon in being able to welcome our next guest here. And I just want to say to you, first of all, you know, when you're in Congress, you represent basically 735,000 people in your congressional district. You can't really know everybody, but when you're the congresswoman who represents Iyanla Vanzant in your congressional district, guess what? You get to know her. And so it gives me great pleasure to introduce somebody today who really is going to share her wisdom that she has learned and lived over the years. She inspires us. She makes us just want to do more. Whether you're talking about her books, In the Meantime, Acts of Faith, or her latest book, Peace, From Broken Pieces, she is so incredibly inspiring. And I just want to mention to you that if you don't get enough here today, or if you're so inspired today, please stop by the room after our networking luncheon, and she will be able to share to sign your very own copy for you. And so I am delighted to be able to be here as co-chair with my friend Cedric Richmond from Louisiana, and to welcome all of you to this conference, and for you to get to know each other and talk to each other and just be inspired by the power and the wisdom of the words that you will hear this afternoon and that you will experience over the next couple of days.
Thank you. Thank you, Donna. And I just want you all to know, and it's, in case you can't tell, how excited I am to be a co-chair and follow the directions of Donna over the next 4 days. I'm extremely excited to carry her bags and follow her directions for the next 4 days. But and the leadership of Shaka Fatah, who's the chairman of the foundation, which helps us with policy and helping students. So I want to thank you all for coming and being a part of this year's annual legislative conference, because it truly is important, and we have to go back to our respective communities and make sure that we continue to make a difference. And that's why we are so excited and so lucky that we have Iyanla Vanzant today. And I will just reiterate what Donna said for a second, that her books are available for sale when this is over, and we would love for you to show her the support, because she did make a sacrifice to be here. And it's so important that we support people who are very positive and helping our communities and enriching our lives. So with that, we will stop our part of the show, and we will recognize Iyanla, and want to be very specific, because I think that her message and our theme is so important. And today she will, her theme is, it starts with you, so now what? And the so now what is the important part as we talk about purpose and making sure that we wake up every day trying to make sure that this world is a better place and change the lives of people who need it. So thank you very much for coming out.
So, has anybody told you that they love you today? If not, just let me be the first to say, I love you today. And when we think about all that's going on in the world, what's going on with our children, what's going on even right here in our schools, what happened recently in Washington, D.C., we got to get to the love, y'all. So right on top of that chicken and that piece of corn, I want y'all to put some love. Put it right on top of that. Am I going to stay up here? Oh, no. I'm coming down there to love on you. How about that? Yeah, you can eat your chicken, but you're gonna have to love on somebody too. Come on, just give me a hand clap. Give me a hand clap. Give me a hand clap. That corn is cold already anyhow. You know this song. You know the words. It's you. You're the one you love. You're the one you need. Oh, it's you. Now what? It's you. We've been looking, waiting, wondering, but you know what? It's you. I see you looking at me like I'm crazy. I ain't scared of you. Come on, give me a hand clap. Y'all been sitting all day. Let's move some calories. Right? It's you. Has anybody told you they love you today? Has anybody told you? I love you today. People walk around all day long and don't never hear I love you. Then they wonder why they look ugly. We gotta put some love on this, y'all. We gotta put some love on our children. We gotta put some love. We gotta put some love in our schools. But first of all, it's you. You need some love. You know you ain't. You know what? Since you know when. Yeah? So let's get some love. Give me a clap. Come on, give me a clap. Come on, give me a clap. Give me a clap. Those must be Republicans over there. Y'all Republicans? Come on, give me a clap or something. What? Okay, now whoever knows the words, who knows the words? Who knows the words? So let me hear you. Let me hear you. Y'all don't know the words. Come on now, it's you. You're the one. Let me hear you. Let me hear you. What? Put your love where? She don't care. She must be a Republican. Come on, baby. Come on, baby. It's you. Come on, act like you know the words. Everybody, say something. Hum. Let's put some love in the room. It's you. Thank you. I bet if Beyonce was here, y'all would be singing. Okay, I give it to him. Can I get a clap? Who loves me today? Yeah, that's good. Now here's the chorus. It's you, come on. There you go. Come on. Come on, come on, baby. Oh, I love it. Come on, let me hear you. Can I call you? Everybody, come on. Republicans over here. Come on, give me a call. Right there in the center. Lady in the red dress, she just bit that lettuce. Come on. I can't hear you. We need some love in the room. We need some love in D.C. We want to send some love out to the families that lost loved ones. Love, come on. We don't need no music. What? Who gonna give me? Come on, baby, it's you. Yes, give yourselves some love. My. How you doing, Washington? Well, y'all go back to your lettuce. Go on back to your lettuce now. How you doing today? Yeah? Good. Come on, sit down so we can pray. Because I don't do nothing without praying. And then what I'm going to do, I'm going to pose. I'm going to do 1, 2, 3. And everybody can get their iPhone. What did we do before iPhones? Oh, I know. We did those horrible throwaway cameras that used to burn your irises out your eyes. Yeah? Just for a moment. Put the cameras down for me. Hold the door for me for a moment. Hold the door. Take a breath with me. Come on, take a breath. I want you to reach out and just touch the hand of the person next to you. Come on, we got to connect. That's how you put love in it. We walk around, we don't even look one another in the eye. We need some love. Y'all can have all the degrees in the world. We can have all the money in the world, but if we ain't loving on ourselves and each other, this thing is going to get real ugly real quick. Yeah, so take a breath with me. Precious Lord of the universe, just now, I just will to do thy will. I don't even have words to express the gratitude for the life in this room, for every mother, every father, every grandmother, every brother, every sister, every man, every woman who sacrificed to be here, whose long journey has brought them here. Even me, God, even me. So we just thank you. I thank you. I lift my hands, my heart, my mind, my life. I give praise and honor to the spirit of my father, Horace Lester Harris, and my mother, Sahara Elizabeth Jefferson, who lent their body to the Creator that I may be born. I ask that my elders in this room and my ancestors, that I bring honor to you in your name by every word that comes forth from my mouth. I acknowledge, accept, and affirm that of myself, I can do no thing, but it is the divine essence and energy within me that does the work, and I'm just so grateful to have been chosen. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart come forth today as a message of healing, truth, and light. May those who have ears hear, those who don't have ears hear. May those who have understanding understand, and those who don't, may they receive it. May they see less of me, God, and more of thee. That today, this room will serve your purpose. We want to thank the organizers, Senator Fatah, Shaka Fatah, and Congresswoman Donna Edwards, and every single volunteer that gave of their time, essence, and energy to make sure this happened. I love you, God. I thank you. I let it be, and so it is. Take a breath. Gently, just gently, let go of the hand you're holding. Gently. because that was an angel, and angels don't like to be manhandled. Good. I know y'all want to eat your chicken, right? Okay, but I got something for y'all to do. So while you're eating your chicken, while you're munching on your corn, I want you to introduce yourself to three people at your table. But I don't, wait a minute, hold on, follow instructions now. I don't want you to tell them your name. I want you to introduce them by telling them something about you. You got one or two things, your weight, your age, or your credit score. Your weight, your age, or your credit score. So it would be, hi, I'm 135. Go on, three people, introduce yourself. Your weight, your age, or your credit score. That's it, you don't have a name. Hi, I'm 162. Hi, I'm 105, soaking wet. All the way in the back, y'all gotta play fair now. Did everybody meet somebody? You people coming in the room, stop and tell three people your weight, your age, or your credit score. She said, what? Go to get to your table. Tell people your weight, your age, or your credit score. Yeah. All right. Now here's what I want to know. Did you tell the truth? Was it hard to tell that truth? Did you choose not to participate at all? Did you give other information than that was required? Did you continue the conversation beyond the instruction given? I'm asking these questions because if you do it anywhere, you do it everywhere. So the same way you behave to this request from the universe is the way you run your life. It's up to you, so now what? How you show up in the world. What you do when you show up. The energy that you bring into the room. All develop and create your circle of influence and what it is that you receive from the universe of life. We live in a universe, think of it this way, it's all cookie dough. We live in a big ball of cookie dough. And every thought you think, every word you speak, every emotion you hold cuts a cookie out of the universe. Some of us got some broken cookies. Just really think about the first thought you had upon hearing that instruction from the universe. Because you may think it's me, Iyanla Vanzant, but the truth is there's nobody but you and God in the room at any given time. And how you respond is even a function of how you treat yourself or how you treat your creator. It's up to you. Now what? Was it hard for you to share? And what thoughts do you have about your weight, your age, and your credit score? Because that's going to determine how you responded to that, determines what happens. It's up to you. Right here in this room, how many people spoke to strangers today? How many people did you just walk up to and smile and laugh and hug them and give yourself to them? Because so very often we are alone in our head without adult supervision, reminding ourselves of what we should not be doing, that the things that we can do and should do, we don't do. It's up to you, now what? So I just want to offer some points about what will support us in creating a grander sphere of influence, increasing our contact opportunities, and creating from the inside to the outside. How many people in this room would like to create something bigger, better, grander, sweeter in their life? Okay, it's up to you. Now what? Be clear. That's point number one. Put that in your iPhone. Be clear about who you are and what you're up to at any given point in time. Be clear about what matters to you, what you value, what you will do, what you won't do, what you can do, and what you can't do. Be clear. Clarity is a gift, and it grows and develops through practice. Be clear. Be clear about who you are. Many, many years ago, when I first started doing this work, and I was writing, I wrote a little purple book called Acts of Faith. And the book had a life all its own. And I was running all over speaking and talking about Acts of Faith and stuff and making money on the book, speaking for $50 and $300 and $200. I had to get clear, because I had on $500 worth of clothes. It was not profitable. But I had to get clear. And Dennis Kimbrough said this to me right in the halls of the old convention center. He said, Iyanla, be clear about what you are. Are you a writer who speaks or a speaker who writes? Sometimes when we do multiple things, we throw them all together and we practice each and we master none. Be clear about who you are, about what you do, what you're up to, what is your primary cause of action and call to action. You gotta be clear. And listening to what Dennis Kimbrough said to me, was I a speaker who writes or a writer who speaks? I said, well, I ain't none of that. That's something that I do, but that's not who I be. Who you be? You've got to get clear about who you be, because being is an internal state. It's not about doing. It's what drives you, what elevates you, what you would do every single day of your life for the rest of your life, whether you got paid or not. That's who you be. What matters to you, that's who you be. What you value, that's who you be. And so many of us are clear about what we have to do, but not clear about who we be as we're doing it. Because some of us want to serve people and we mean it in a wet cat on any given Sunday. Who get clear about who you be? So after researching within my soul about that question, I said, I'm not a writer or a speaker, I'm a teacher. And what I do is create curriculum. And then I talk about it. And from that day, 23 years ago, I have governed my life as a teacher. Now, y'all may think I'm a celebrity when you see me in Walmart and I'm just trying to buy the cheap soap powder. I'm a teacher getting what's on sale. Or when you see it on television, I am a teacher. Are you clear about who you be? And are you clear about what you value? Are you clear about what matters to you? I had a very wonderful experience last Friday. Friday the 13th, I turned 60 years old. I'm telling you, it was truly a wonderful thing. I remember when I was 30, I had a party. When I was 35, I had a party. When I was 40, I had a party. I had all these parties. At 60, I turned the phone off. And after I sat for a moment and really got still within my being, I was so filled with joy because I didn't want nothing. You know, we go through life trying to fill our wants, but at this time in my life, this series, these wisdom years that I've walked into, it's like, it's not about having many wants, it's about having few needs. And who you be determines what you want and how you go about getting it, and what you need and how you trust it will be filled. Be clear. We got to be clear. Be clear about your purpose, your protocols, and your plans. Put that in the iPad. Your purpose. At any given moment, what is your purpose? When you call somebody to tell them what somebody said, what is your purpose? When you don't tell somebody information that they need, what is your purpose? And what is the protocol? Protocol means what are the values and the virtues that govern your character and your life. You got to be clear. There are some things that we just can't do. We just can't do it. It is just not helpful. But when you look at your purpose, what you're up to at any given moment, and the highest possible calling for that, your protocols, your values, your standards, your boundaries, be clear about your boundaries. If you got people in your life who are behaving badly, it's because they are there by energetic invitation. They didn't just pass by. I always say this to women when I'm doing work and they say, all men are dogs. I say, well, why are the dogs on your porch? Okay? If it's in your life, it is there by energetic invitation. Some thought, some belief, some learning, some perception, some understanding, some wound, some trauma, some hurt is calling the ugliness and the cooties into your life. Who got cooties? Don't look now. Don't look now. Cooties are simply a buildup of toxic energy. I had cooties. I ain't ashamed. I recognize a cootie now from a mile away because I'm clear. Oh, that's a cootie coming. Okay? Some of us see cooties and invite them over to dinner. Now, cooties can have two legs, four legs. Cooties can be a thought. Cooties can be a word. But it's a buildup of toxic energy. And one of the things my beloved daughter, Jamia, before she passed away, Jamia was a master aromatherapist. She would whip together an oil if your hair was falling out, if your eye hurt, if you got a corn, she would make you an oil for it. Now, I'm an herbalist. I learned it naturally from my Native American grandmother. And so she came to me one day, she says, I wanna create something good for the feet. What kind of herb can I put in it? Because people have cooties on their feet. I said, what you mean cooties on the feet? She said, you know, people walk in anger, people walk in shame, people walk in guilt, people walk in meanness, people walk in sadness, and that creates cooties. That was my child. She was brilliant. She got that from me. Thank you. You know, we're not talking about shoes. We're talking about energy. Have you ever been somewhere and you just walk in and you say, ew? Or you sit down next to somebody and you say, cooties. Those are cooties. So Jamia started making body products that not only cleared your energy, not only cleaned your body, but cleared your energy. She did the research. I did the herbs. And she created this whole line of body products called Masterpiece, P-E-A-C-E. Because she said, when you walk in anger and sadness and shame and lack of confidence, you got the masterpiece. Because peace will bring you back to a natural state of being and help you create boundaries. So let me tell you about the masterpiece. When Jamia passed away, I thought it was gonna just go away, but energy is energy. And one day I woke up and I heard as if she was speaking right into my ear, go ahead and do masterpiece. And I'm like, do masterpiece? I don't know nothing about masterpiece. And right behind that, I heard, use black soap. How many people in this room have ever been to the continent of Africa? Did you notice, like I did, there were two things I noticed. In South Africa, I noticed how big the sisters' butts were. Because in South Africa, I was thin. It was really beautiful. It was just, you know, and I was thin in South Africa. I noticed how big the people's butts were. And in East, West, and South Africa, I noticed how clear the skin was. They got some beautiful navy, purple, black skin. It was delicious. And they used black soap, handmade by the grandmothers and the mothers in the fields, in the yards, and you just buy it on the street. So what I did was I extended the masterpiece line using black soap, using herbs, and most of all, using prayer. Because some of us can't get clean and clear because our energy is so toxic. It's up to you. Now what? Be clear. Create boundaries. Create boundaries so that people don't come into your life behaving badly. Have you ever had anybody just come up in your life behaving badly? You thought you were doing a favor for them. You let Aunt Tilly's nephew Boo-Boo sleep on your couch rent-free, and now Boo-Boo done ate up all the food, stole your jewelry, and broke your TV. Boundaries. When to say yes and when to say no. Ladies, raise your hand. Okay, raise your hand. Raise it high so I can see. Don't be shy. If you know how to and enjoy and have a firm hand on saying no, put your hand down. Mm-hmm. Boundaries require that you have a strong no. A no that will protect you, a no that will support you, and a no that will advance your yes. Because if you have a weak no, you're gonna have a weak yes. You'll say yes because you feel obligated. You'll feel yes because you feel responsible. You'll say yes because you don't wanna upset people. But when you have a strong no about what you will do, what you won't do, about your boundaries, when you're clear about who you be and what you're up to, your purpose in the world, oh, you have a real strong no. I gave a student an assignment once to come up with 109 ways to say no. No. Nope. No. No, beloved. No. Oh, hell to the no. You can say no with dignity. No. You can say no with attitude. No. You can say no prayerfully. No. But you gotta have a strong no. You gotta build it from the inside out so that you don't say yes to things that you're not clear about, that don't honor who you be, that don't honor the things that you value. It's up to you. Your no will save you. Be clear. Be clear. Be authentic. Be authentic. Many people don't even know what that means. It means that you're clear about who you are. You're clear about your purpose, your protocols, and your plans. You're clear about what you're up to, and you speak the truth of that all the time. Be authentic means you're in integrity, that what you think, what you say, what you feel, and what you do all matter. Now, I know that's hard in Washington, because there's just some truths you can't tell out here. But we want to do the best that we can. And when you can't, pray about it. But be authentic. So many of us don't allow people to know who we are. As I travel around this country, I meet people all over the country who are suffering in silence because they're not authentic about what they need, what they want, what they're doing, what they're experiencing. I just came from a place where there was a couple who were engaged in domestic violence. Young couple, 29, 30 years old. And whenever he would get upset, he would choke her and throw things at her and call her out her name. I lived like that for 9 years, and now my no is very, very clear. If you even look like you were sitting on the bus next to somebody that had a thought after a conversation with somebody that thought they could hit me, it's going to be a problem. But they didn't know that the behavior that they were engaging in was considered domestic violence. No boundaries. And she never told anyone, and he never told anyone. They never shared with anyone the authentic experience of their marriage. Now, I know y'all are looking at me, some horrified, but there's some of us right up here in this room who ain't being authentic about what we need, about what we want, about who we are, about what we're up to, about how we feel. Be authentic in your life. Let people know who you are and what matters. Otherwise, you'll never be able to network and connect and expand your sphere of influence, your sphere of connection. Be authentic, be clear, be authentic. Know who you be, know what you're up to. Know what it is that matters to you, what you value, and do that. You know, the good thing is for us women, once you cross 50, you be clear about who you are because you forget everything else. Who am I today? it gets good, so you don't have to worry. Just, you have to be authentic, you know, because you have to say, anybody see my glasses? Because I put them down, I can't. Let me tell you the funny joke. Okay, I've always said that I went to sleep on the day of my 40th birthday. I could see perfectly. And I woke up the next day and I couldn't see. Something happens to your eyeballs at 40. Your vision just goes away. Well, when my son turned 40, he came upstairs. He was reading something and he had to do this. I said, oh my God, it happens to men too! Who knew? Being authentic is going to Target and getting some readers instead of talking about the little print on the paper. You know you can't see. They have nice ones, even at the Dollar Tree. You can get them at the Dollar Tree and put one in every room like I did. Be authentic, tell the truth, shame the devil. I got one pair in every room, different colors. I want to change what I'm seeing. I want to change what I'm seeing. And I learned that a very special way because it really is up to me to determine what I see as a possibility. It's up to you to determine what you see as possibilities. When people call me, oh, Iyanla, we want you to help us do this and help us do that because we can't, I'm done. Mm-mm. Means you say can't to me, I'm finished with you because that's going to be an impossible track. You can only have what you can see. That's why you gotta be clear. So anyway, who here loves a sale? See, that's good, right? And do people be bothering you when you be shopping on the sale? No, so don't bother me when you see me shopping on the sale rack. So they were having a sale at Lens Crafters, the eyeglass place. Now, I didn't wear eyeglasses, but they were having a sale. I can't pass up a sale, and particularly a two for sale, two for something. So they were having two eye exams for $39.99. That is $10 an eye. How could I pass that up? So my grandson, Adeshola, he wears glasses. So I snatch him up and we go running off to Lens Crafter. Me and my grandson, the good grandmother, I'm going to get his eyes examined to see if he needs new glasses. So I got the free eye exam. Now, you have to be authentic, right? I hadn't had my eyes examined since we used to do the E's. Like the E was this way and this way and this way. You remember that? Do y'all remember that? I ain't the only old person up in this room. Stop it. So now they got a machine. Who knew? You have to look in the machine and then you see all the little lines of letters and they tell you, and they're lovely, they're different colors and everything. And then they do this test for glaucoma. Yeah, and they don't tell you it's coming. They just say, we're gonna test you for a glaucoma. And then they spit this powder in your eye and to see if you have it. You may not have glaucoma, but you cannot see because the stuff hangs on your lashes. So then they did the other tests, and they put me in all these wonderful machines, and look here, look there. And the eye doctor, her name was Dr. Apple. Isn't that cute? Dr. Apple for the eyes. I like, y'all are a dead group. That really was entertaining, you know. Dr. Apple, the eye doctor, okay? Let me talk to these people. Those are the Republicans over there. Anywho, so when I go in to see Dr. Apple to get the results of all the eye exam, she says to me, Miss Vanzant, where are your current glasses? What you mean? I don't wear no glasses. Because a diva can't wear no glasses unless they fly glasses. She said, oh, so you've never had glasses, Miss Vanzant? No, why? I need them. She said, Miss Vanzant, you need not one, not two, but three pair of glasses. One for reading, one for driving, and one for seeing. I said, well, I can see perfectly fine. She said, no, 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 no. She said, your eyes will adjust to the level of deficiency present. Let me go over here, because the Republicans need to hear this. Your eyes will adjust to the level of deficiency that is present, and very often when our energy is toxic, when our identity is not authentic, when we're stuck on doing and not being, we adjust ourselves to deficiencies and lacks and limitations and live that way thinking it's the only thing that's available. Oh, your eyes will adjust. Be clear. Check your vision in both eyes. Be authentic. Be authentic. There are some people that you just are not gonna like. Don't invite them to dinner. That'll create cooties at the table. There are some people that are not gonna like you. That ain't their job, nor is it their responsibility. Don't take it personally, but tell the truth about how you feel about it. Be authentic. Don't adjust to limitation. No more can'ts and no more whining. No whining. I'm implementing a national holiday called No Whining Wednesdays. On Wednesday, you can't whine about nothing. What you don't have, what you can't do, what somebody did, it's up to you. Not only does whining create cooties and toxicity in your energy, it convinces your subconscious mind that what you're saying is true because you want to believe what you say. Be clear, be authentic, have boundaries, check your vision, do what matters to you, and know what you value. What do you value? What do you value? You know what? Excuse me, gentlemen, I just have to talk to the ladies for a minute. Y'all hum or something, act like you don't hear this. Can anybody remember the day that they saw the first little cellulite lump? Am I by myself? And, oh, you didn't hear me? I said, can you remember the day you saw your first cellulite lump? Did you hear that? Do you remember the day? Did that puppy not multiply by the next day had his cousins, his first cousin, neighbor? And then didn't they jump over to the other leg? It's like every time you look down, there were more of the cellulite cooties coming. How many people bought that stuff they sell on the TV at 2 o'clock in the morning? That's he had I been sleep, resting, drinking more water, the cellulite would have helped itself. But since I was up at 2 o'clock working, looking at the television, I spent $49.99, rubbed myself raw, and the cellulite was still growing. So, oh, it was just terrible. I wouldn't look in the mirror. I wouldn't do this. I couldn't do that. Limiting myself to the limitation of what it looked like to me. And, you know, I'm the kind of person when all else fails, then I pray. I started praying on the cellulite. Please go away. Your good is elsewhere. Go there quickly. Please leave me. I bless you off into your goodness. And one day as I was praying, I heard this, because this is the kind of relationship I have with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit said, fool, do you want legs with cellulite or no legs? I got so happy about that cellulite. I wanted to paint it, make it into artwork. Because sometimes we get so caught up in what's wrong until we miss what's right. We're looking at things from a limited perception, from somebody else's ideas about it. We're not clear or authentic. I value my legs. Who cares if they got cellulite? Because I'm sure a person with no legs would love to have these. We got to start thinking that way. I'm going to talk to you about two more things. Love and forgiveness. I don't care what it is that you're doing in this world. I know many of you are involved in the government here, and we have so many elected officials and people who are serving the world in so many ways. But if you don't love what you're doing, run for your life. Run for your life. If 3 days out of the five you doing your work, you complain more than you bless, run for your life. If you're continually looking at what you don't have and what people aren't doing, as opposed to looking how blessed you are to be in a position to start, run for your life. You got cooties and you need to run for your life. You take yourself right over to that table, get you some black soap, get the purification, and clean up them cooties so that we can be clear. We've got to learn how to love. And some of us have been given a very distorted perspective of what love is. Love isn't about clinging and holding on. If you really love something, you love it enough to let it go free. You know how I learned that? I learned that ending a 40-year relationship that brought me face down in the mud with love and forgiveness. It was not pretty. I didn't want to be down in the mud on my face. But I had a distorted image of love. And I thought love was about control. You know, control is the number one human addiction. People get high on it every day. But people want to control to keep themselves safe. People want to control because they fear. Love is not about fear. If you are really, really loving something or someone, the great mystic and philosopher Howard Thurman, right out of Howard University, wrote, I just want to be more loving. That don't mean that people won't piss you off, but your response to it has to be loving. That doesn't mean that you won't have days where you just feel ugly. You know what? I give myself moments of madness. I'll get up in the morning where I just feel mean and nasty and ugly. I'm in my house. I ain't nobody. I won't comb my hair. I won't brush my teeth. I won't even shower. I just walk around being mean and nasty and ugly. thinking ugly thoughts about people, writing down my cusses and my gossip. I just get myself until I can't stand myself. But I'm a human being. Sometimes you just have to do that. You gotta have a moment of madness, then acknowledge that what it was, and then move on to the next thing. How long do you think you can stay unwashed, hair uncombed, teeth unbrushed? But give yourself permission to do that when you need to. Anyway, I ended a 40-year relationship. In and out of this relationship with this one person that I really thought I loved for 40 years. 40. Who in this room ain't 40? So my relationship was older than you. 40 years, married twice. Oh, what? Please, pay attention to what you be doing. Okay, particularly in relationships, be clear. Have a purpose, a protocol, boundaries. Be authentic. Be clear about who you are, what you want, who you be. Have a strong no, have a strong yes. That was just a side. Put those in your notes. Anywho, after the second marriage, which I wasn't being authentic in. Shoot me, I'm human, okay. But I was married, okay. I had adjusted to the level of deficiency that was present. I had adjusted to that. Who am I talking to up in here right now? I heard an amen out that corner. Woo! I had adjusted to it. Mm-hmm. You know, you just get into the habit of doing and you forget about being. So, one day he had a stroke of genius and left me. How you leave Iyanla Vanzant? What is wrong with you? He sure did pack right up. So long, Sammy, I am going away. Okay. Oh, you want to talk about high pissosity? Who knows about pissosity? That's two levels above rage and one decimal point below madness. Because pissosity hits you first in your mouth. That's when the evil lip monster takes over your tongue and proceeds to use it to lash and bash and beat. Oh, nobody don't know what I'm talking about. Okay. So I was in high pissosity because in my mind, I thought that I was in love. And see, when you're not being authentic in your work, in your relationships, in your way of being, that ain't love because you're withholding yourself and people fall in love with who you're not. And then when the real you shows up, they get confused. You understand? So withholding how you feel and who you are and what you need and what you want and calling it love, you have adjusted to a level of deficiency that is not going to help you do what you want to do and be who you want to be. It's up to you. Now what? When you recognize this ain't working, I don't have to have a reason. I don't have to have an explanation. This ain't working for me. The cooties are flying. They don't feel good. I am out. But that requires courage, which I didn't have. Because you stay somewhere too long, live away too long, give and not receive for too long, it really does eat your courage up. You won't have the courage or the strength to go. So anyway, he left. But I'm a spiritual individual. So I knew I had to forgive. I had to forgive him, and I had to forgive her. Because you know there was a her. There was a her! If you're gonna go by yourself, don't be taking nobody with you. So I had to forgive. But I gave myself a moment of madness and stayed in my pissosity for about 6 months. Tell the truth, be authentic. That's a hard thing, yeah? But then I discovered that anger and rage and madness causes wrinkles. Black soap and lack of anger. Looking good. So I started to forgive. I forgive you, damn it. Oh, I forgive. And I recognized that was not gonna work. So I started writing it. Take it from my mind, through my eyes, and make it solid. Did you get that? Your plan. Take it from your mind, bring it through your eyes, make it solid. If it ain't on paper, it don't exist. Once it's on paper, it will exist. It's up to you to write it down. Anywho, let me tell you all my tragic love story. So I started writing down forgiveness. I started writing down. And you know that when you write and it goes through 8 sheets of paper, you know you're pretty pissed off. So I recognized I had to take this thing seriously or the ugly cooties was gonna get me. So I started writing it and then reading it. I forgive you. And then I had to get clear, well, what are you forgiving him for? Well, I forgive you for embarrassing me in public. You know, sometimes you have some really shallow things that you have to forgive. Just start with them, okay? You gotta eat the elephant one bite at a time and don't start at the butt. Start with the easy stuff. Okay, I forgive. I forgive you for embarrassing me publicly. I forgive you for taking up with somebody I know. I forgive you for not paying the bills when you left. I forgive you that now I got to take the trash down that quarter of a mile hill to the foot to the thing every Sunday night. I forgive you for that. I forgive you for showing up in my life. I forgive your mother for having you. Be authentic. Be authentic. This was in my journal, and I have the courage to tell you, ain't nobody ever gonna see it. What you gonna put in your journal? I forgive your father for marrying your mother. I'll leave it just right there. I'll just leave it right there, okay? I forgive. And I forgive myself for not being willing to let you go. And I forgive myself for staying longer than it was necessary or productive to do so. Oh, I forgive myself for telling myself that the nasty little things that you used to say to me didn't matter. You see, that's when you know you're there. Because it's up to you. You can forgive other people, but until you can be authentic and clear and forgive yourself for the way you treated yourself, nothing's gonna change. It's up to you. Now what? What you gonna do? You gonna lie to yourself in your own journal? Get a grip. I forgive myself. And that's where I did that forgiveness every day for 40 days, every single day for 40 days. I wrote it, everything. I wouldn't even allow myself to judge it or feel bad about it. I just went to the depths of my soul because what mattered to me was peace and love. And I wasn't being loving to him or to myself. And I had to clean it up. There was nothing a doctor could do for me, a psychologist, I was crazy in love. What they said, what Beyonce sang that too, right? Got me looking so crazy like that. I was looking crazy to my own self. And I didn't have nothing to do with him. So anywho, 40 days later, I'm driving home in the car. And you know, your creator, your God, your ancestors, your angels, they will bring you what you need when you need it. But you gotta be clear about what it is so that when it shows up, you can recognize it. I wanted peace. That's what I wanted. So I'm in the car driving, flipping the radio, out on 50, going home. Pouring rain. I mean, the rain was pouring down in sheets and buckets all over the place. Just raining. And I turned the radio on, and this song came on. The Shekinah Glory Ministry. Singing Yes. Have you heard that song? Will your heart and soul say yes. If I told you what I really need, would you still say yes? So the song came on and I'm just driving along, and I knew what I needed to do was let go. Let go. Just let go. In my mind, in my heart, the limitations, the cooties, the pain, the hurt, the fantasy, all let go. And when that song came on, I just began to weep on 50 in the rain. It was an ugly cry. Things flowing all over my little leather steering wheel. And God loves me. God said, fool, pull over. Either pull over or turn the radio off. This is really not helpful, what you're doing right now. So I pulled over to the side of the road because I don't know about you, but some music just ministers to my soul. And I needed to hear it. When the song says, I'm calling you higher. I'm calling you out of your dry places. I'm calling you higher. Oh, and I was just a weeping and a weeping and a weeping. And I believe that whenever you're crying, whenever you're weeping, whenever you're sad, you're sorrowful, you're upset, give yourself permission to do it, but have an agenda. Don't just be mean for no reason. Don't just be wasting tears. Why am I crying? Why am I crying? Why am I crying? And I heard clearly from the depths of my being, you're crying because you're in love.
I'm in love. I am. With who?
Because we never think of just being in love. In the presence of love. Right now. All around us. At your table. In your being, just in love. Whenever we think about being in love, we want to project it outward and make it about somebody else. It's about you. Now what? People don't bring love into your life. They come into your life to show you the depth of love you are capable of giving and receiving. It's you. So you're in love.
Okay, with who?
With her.
Her?
Her who? Did I switch sides? And then it came to me. I loved her, my sister, because she loved him and made him feel better when I wasn't willing to do so. She was there for him when I wasn't willing to be. I was out here trying to heal y'all. He home by himself. I loved her because when I saw him, he really did look good. And don't you hate it when your ex looks good? Don't you want him like bent over, crippled with warts on their face or something? Be authentic! He looked good. He looked happy. And when you love somebody, you want them happy. You want them joyful, fruitful, prosperous. You want them peaceful and blessed. I loved her because she reminded him of who he was. And she showed me who I was being. Inauthentic. Saying one thing and doing another. Feeling one thing and thinking something else. Oh, I loved her. She had my husband, but she became my teacher. I loved her. And when I thought about it and I sat there and the tears stopped flowing and I thought about myself loving this woman who was loving my husband, I said, Iyanla, you have lost your mind. There's something wrong with you. But can I tell you something? When you start getting to those deeper levels of truth, when you really start understanding who you be, when you get clear about what you value and what matters and what you be up to, when you have character and when you have purpose and protocols and a plan, truth don't have to make sense. You don't need anybody's agreement. You need their support. And if you have the support of your creator, your angels, your ancestors, the Holy Spirit, you can move mountains. It's up to you. Now what? Now, We did not have a bitter, nasty divorce. We're not good friends. We do talk and see one another. I would never invite them to Thanksgiving dinner. Be authentic. But I'm happy for them. But more important, I'm happy for me. That I can live and stand in that level of truth. Can you hear me? It's up to you. What you gonna do? Stay stuck in limitation? Be who you are? Without apology, without defense, love yourself through and forgive the people that don't know how to receive your love. What matters to you? What values to you? Don't get caught up in your weight or your credit score or your age. Just be you. Because as long as you're here, you got a chance. You got an opportunity. So now, here's what I want you to do. I want you to introduce yourself to three people at that table. But this time, I want you to tell them how many people you want to touch in the world. I want you to tell them your vision for yourself and the thing that matters to you. Or I want you to tell them what really matters to you. How many people you want to touch in the world, your vision for what you want to do in the world, or your what really matters to you. Go on, introduce yourself to three people. What really matters to you? How many people you want to impact or touch in the world? Your vision. Talk about your vision. What's your vision? What really, really matters to you? How many people do you want to impact in the world? Now, let me just ask you a question. Isn't that a very different conversation than the first one you had about stuff that is in flux and can change at any moment? This is what it feels like to share who you be. Because when you share who you be, you can, they ain't listening to me. Let me just shut up. They are not listening to me. They in it. Didn't that feel different? Did it feel better? If it felt better, give yourselves a hand clap. That is what it feels like to share who you be. Can you hear me? And that's where we want to live for. It's up to us now. We have to take off the mask and take off the differences and the oppositions and the challenges, the limitations, and live from that place. So, I want you to share who you be with me. On your table, look at this. Hello? You're gonna miss it. There's a card. If you fill this card out and you leave it with me, let me tell you what we're gonna do. We're gonna send you the 5 salient points from this address, in addition to some additional information about how you can be better. All you gotta do is fill it out and turn. Please write like it's a kindergarten. Make your strokes, your circle and your line. Also, at the top of the card, it tells you about what we're up to in the Washington, D.C., Atlanta, Chicago area. Okay, fill that out for me, and you can leave it at the table, or we'll collect it out the door. If you're interested in killing cooties, not killing, we don't kill. If you're interested in releasing cooties, this is what Masterpiece looks like. It's called Jamia's Masterpiece. It's my daughter's product, and we have some in the back. I want to tell you how I make this. I hand make it. I want y'all, because people have fantasies about what it means to be on TV, but I know what matters to me. I buy black soap in 5-pound blocks, and I shred it on a regular tree shredder. And I soak it in distilled water and 5-gallon glass jugs. And while the soap is dissolving in the water, I play crystal healing music by Dr. Emoto, who says that you can change the chemical composition of a thing by simply exposing it to high vibration. Then I take herbs, fresh herbs, that I buy, find, pick, a variety of herbs, and I dry them, and I crush them, and I pray over them, and they go in the soap. And then I make my oil formula according to Jamia's recipe, and that goes in the soap. There are no chemicals in it at all. None whatsoever. There's black soap, there's prayer, there's love, there's herbs, there's oil. That's how you kill a cootie. So we will send you the salient notes from this presentation, this lecture. I want to thank the Congressional Black Caucus, Congress Senator Shaka Fatah, Congresswoman Doris Edwards, and the brother from New Orleans I met. I can't remember. I'm old. Forgive me. I would just want to thank you for. I live right here in D.C., and this is the first time I've ever spoken at the caucus luncheon, but it won't be the last time. So they told me to ask you, do you have a question? Do we have mics for the question askers? There's the mics. There's a mic. If there's an inquiry you want to make of me, before the cootie soap fell to the floor. All right, so you're going to have to keep that. Yeah? No questions. There's one right here. Okay. Let me ask this question first. If you learned something today, clap your hand. I'm a teacher. I got to make sure the students got a lesson, okay? Yes, beloved.
Hi, my name is Reese, and I'm a CBCF fellow, and I've been a huge fan of Iyanla Fix My Life, as well as your books, for a very long time. One of the things about being authentic is once I make up in my mind what I'm going to do, there's a path between where I currently am, because I've not been authentic, to where I want to be.
Yeah.
And to sustain myself between where I am right now and where I want to be is the question. You have to financially take care of yourself in the meantime. And so if you went to law school but you want to be a photographer, how do you...
I went to law school.
Make that journey.
So what is your question?
How do you get from where you are when you're being inauthentic to where you want to be? How do you sustain yourself in the meantime?
You never have to be inauthentic. I don't care where you are. Authenticity means simply sharing the truth of who you are, who you be, what you're up to, what you're doing. You know, I'm not on television because I'm a celebrity. I'm on television because at 57 years old, I made an affirmation. I want to reach the largest number of people with the least amount of effort. That was the affirmation. That could have been radio, television, the internet. What showed up was television. So you got to be, you can be authentic where you are. And I'll tell you what got me from the place of needing to support myself financially and to where I am today. Want to know how I got there? My daily spiritual practice. My daily spiritual practice. Because after 40 years in a relationship that I thought was love, I realized that something was wrong with my thinking. So I had to think higher and move higher. The guidance that you need will come to you. It's up to you, but you gotta tap into it. You never have to be authentic, and there is already a path for you to get to where you go, because your creator never gives you a vision without the provision. If you got the vision, the provision is waiting. But if you don't have a daily spiritual practice, if you don't have a relationship with your creator, you can't tap into it. So it is possible. Yeah? Got that? Okay, F7 enter. Let me see you do that. F7 enter. Got it. Okay. Anybody else? Because I'm going. Oh, there it is. What's, you see, the Republicans, they just will not cooperate. And people over there.
Hi. I was really inspired by what you're speaking about today. My question is, when you have done everything that... I'm sorry, I should have caught that from the first one. When I understand everything that you've shared with us and you're still feeling, you know who you are. I know who I am.
Who are you?
Oh, me?
Yeah, ain't you the one talking?
Okay. Well,
who are you?
I am a loving mother and wife. And I write. That's it. So if
that's
I know,
it. Did you
well,
hear that?
Well, that's not all, that's, but you
well,
know.
Yeah. But this, hear what I'm saying. Who are you? You see, I am Iyanla.
Fair.
I am a devoted, reverent servant of God. I am a teacher. I am a bold, beautiful, powerful black woman sent here to be a midwife to other women so that every step I take is a demonstration to another woman about who she be and how she be. That's who I am.
Wow. Well, I'm going to have to work on my one line. I'm going to go back to the drawing
board. It don't have to sound like mine, but it can be I'm a loving mother and a wife and I write.
I'll
Not
do better.
I am a writer.
I will do better. I will do better.
Okay.
But my question is, once I understand and am able to articulate exactly who I am, one of the things about me that I have difficulty with is that I'm not as outgoing.
I have not in the past.
I have not mastered being more outgoing and sharing who I am with other people. Oh. So if I've gotten the wonderful, you know, way to say who
okay,
I am.
Okay, what's your question?
What do I do
to
get beyond? What do I do to be able to share what I now know about myself?
You are not asking the question you want to ask.
I'm not asking the right question.
No, it's not that it's not the right question. There's something you want to know, and you're not asking the question.
Can shy people get through, once you know, what do you do with it if you have a very, like I am shaking right now, having a difficult time.
Okay.
Falling apart.
So you have to make another choice.
What do you do?
You have to make another choice. What matters to you?
Okay.
What do you value? Once you understand what matters to you, you have to make that more important than being shy. You have to make that more important than being safe. And you may have to look at what wounds or challenges or issues from childhood make you think that you don't deserve to be seen and heard. You got to go all the way back there.
That's good.
All right, so you got to ask the right question.
Thank you.
Okay, we got one more. Oh, a man is going to ask a question. Yay.
You addressed what I was going to ask.
Oh, that wasn't you. Okay, go ahead. I did.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
I didn't, and I'll hand it to him. I didn't know if you have had caustic relationships in your family. I see you heal families on television. So I'm wondering what you would suggest if you want to work on healing your own family relationships.
Do they want to heal?
That's the question I'm not sure of.
Well, then you need to find out. Healing means to make whole again, to restore again, to bring into a state of well-being. You can do that without anybody changing, but are they willing to do that? Healing doesn't mean that we all sitting around over tofu singing kumbaya. That may not. They may still be crazy. They may still be whatever they are. You know, but you can still heal your family or make a choice to love them from a distance. It's a choice. You have to make a choice. Okay? Yes, my beloved.
All praises to the Most High.
Yes.
I am Kujenga Eliah Ashe. This is my wife, Lene. We're from Columbus, Ohio. We are the founders of the economic rights movement, not civil rights. The economic rights movement.
Right.
My question is, which major television station should we approach first in order to get the message out about the economic rights movement, if you have?
You know what? I can't answer that. You got to pray guidance on that one. As I said, if you have a vision, God has the provision. I'm just a human being. So if that's the vision and the purpose that's been placed on your heart, the same essence that placed it on your heart will tell you what to do with it. Okay? I can't do that. I don't want to get myself in trouble. So, did you fill out your card? You going to leave it for me? Did you learn something today? Are you going to use it? It's up to you. Now what? What you going to do? I'll tell you what I learned to do. And I've been doing this for the last 2 years. Every single day that I wake up, I pray this prayer that I know. God, what would you have me do? Where would you have me go? What would you have me say and to whom? Not for what I can get, but for what I can give. So each day of my life that I wake up, I want to give a little more. And I give myself away every day. I give what I know. I give who I am. I give what I have. I just give myself away. So it's up to you now to give. To give what you know. Stop waiting for the right time. Just give it. Stop waiting until you're better at it. Just give it. Stop waiting till you have more money. Just give.
I give myself away.
Give yourself away.
So you
every single day.
Can use me.
And if you give yourself away every day, you're going to be amazed at the things that life is going to do through you. It's when we're holding on afraid that we don't have enough, that we're not enough, that we can't be enough, that we live with a very limited perspective. We live in deficit. So this is my theme song. I give myself away.
I give myself away.
So you can use me.
So you
not manipulate me. Not use me up.
I just give myself away.
Oh, you know the words. Yeah. Because we want to be used.
What would happen?
For a higher
the
purpose.
Generation embrace.
You know, so here's the words. That's what you got to say. Here I am.
Here I am.
Take my hand. God, your life, my life is in your hands, God. I'm so longing to see. Yeah. I want to be who you want me to be, God. I tried being who I am, and that didn't work. So you know what? I want your desire, God. Come on, let me hear my chorus. Here we go, here we go. What do you say?
I give myself away.
Every single day. Just give yourself away. Give yourself away. Give yourself away. Stop holding your gifts. Go on and write that book. Write it in a black and white notebook with a pencil. Yeah? Because once it's done, you'll be provided with what you need. Would you go on and open that business, please?